Another shot towards Shaldren, this time by McDonough. And he's able to make the save. And now sticks and gloves get up after the whistle as Sorelli is going after Giordano. And down goes Sorelli. He's right back up again. And this carries over behind the net.
Now McDonough jumps in there to help out as the Lightning were a little outmanned. So now he gets in there to make it 5-on-5. And keep in mind, this could be a potential first round matchup. And Giordano, the one guy for the Leafs that is out there that most likely could handle himself in any type of situation. I think the rest of the Leafs that are on the ice, I would say not so much, as you got Tavares, Liljegren, Nylander, and perhaps Bunting could as well, but the main culprit was Giordano with Sorelli. We'll see how this shakes out.
Looks like two each to the box. Tavares and Giordano in the box for Toronto. It looks like Sorelli and Hagel, I believe, both in the box for Tampa Bay.
Yeah, initially it was Giordano and Sorelli that got into it. Hagel joined in afterwards. Obviously for the Leafs, a frustrating second down at the other end. Looked like they're going to go.
And now they will. They drop the gloves at center ice. Wayne Simmons said, Maroons never dropped the gloves with me. They were calling each other soft. And now right in front of Leah Hextall, they finally will go at it.
These are two tough guys. And with Wayne Simmons, he's got tremendous reach. If he gets loose, he can really start to land them.
And Maroon comes back and answers. This is a true heavyweight battle. And the officials letting them go. And now Maroon and Simmons both with a big smile on their face.
Well, that'll
and
be
now
it.
Simmons says that's enough.
Yeah, well, it was a good job by Maroon. He did a good job of tying up that right hand of Simmons. And he knows, I mean, if Simmons gets loose with the reach, that's where he can do some damage. And Simmons trying to provide a spark for his team. Not able to land the punches he wanted, but let's see if the Leafs are able to respond to that little tussle.
Chips in. Into the corner. It's 4-on-2. The manpower advantage to Toronto. And now we've got a power play upcoming. A penalty is going to be called. And again, sticks and gloves after the whistle.
Sorelli was involved initially. I believe it was with Bunting. Which makes me wonder if Bunting perhaps maybe threw an elbow on Sorelli as he was tied up along the wall.
Number 58, Toronto, 2 minutes elbowing.
Yeah, that's what I thought. I mean, Sorelli had Bunting up against the wall. Here comes Bunting, and it was kind of a flyby elbow, and you can see Sorelli took exception to it, and then one more elbow by Bunting as the frustration continues for the Leafs.
I think it was that retaliation left elbow. That was when he kills some time and continues to be a pest. And now it's on net. Shaldren has to cover up, and now Paul gets into it after the whistle. As Blackwell wants a piece of Paul.
Well, the Leafs, there's no doubt that they are annoyed tonight. And Nick Paul and the work that he did there on the penalty kill, you can see why it would annoy the Toronto Maple Leafs. Blackwell showing his frustration, but a good job on the penalty kill for Tampa Bay again. I mean, the one good look that the Leafs had was to Riley, and he couldn't handle it. And eventually the puck went down the other end of the ice. Thanks to Nick Paul, and Paul engages in a little bit of extracurricular at that point. Here's Paul, the chip, And then the puck protection. He's able to use that big frame to hold on to it and eventually win this puck against two Leafs, get it to the net. And this is where Colin Blackwell, you can see the frustration set in.
Terrific play by Paul, though. He went from possible scoring opportunity to ragging the puck to the corner to kill time to working his way through three Leafs to still getting a shorthanded scoring opportunity that had to be stopped by Schalgren.
It's been a great night special team wise for this Leaf, for this Lightning team. I mean, you think about it, the early kill at the start of the second period, to me, there was no momentum gained by Toronto on that power play. They simply didn't get any shots on goal. And then the Lightning get to work. And as I mentioned before, Paul, Brandon Hagel, these additions to the Lightning have helped bolster their penalty kill, and they gained momentum from it, and then the power play took over.
Let's check in with Leah.
All right, guys. Well, we see Jason Spezza here having a few words. Guess who he's talking to on the Tampa bench? It is none other than Pat Maroon once again, who after Wincerelli went to the bin, he just leaned over the bench, and he continued to just stare down this Toronto team.
Well, there's a very strong possibility that in about 10 days' time, these two teams will renew acquaintances for the possible first of seven.
I wonder if Pat Maroon just asked guys on the other team how many Stanley Cup rings they have. I wonder if that's how he starts the confrontations.
And Sorelli's being sent up the tunnel as the chirping continues between the benches. Now John Tavares getting into it, as he is leaning down, Leah, apparently to have something to say to Maroon as well.
Well, there's a few comments here, but I think it's important to know that right now what Maroon and Corey Perry are like, come after one of us, we'll take care of you. They're defending.
And short side. It looks like Vasilevsky was able to keep it out of the net. And now Simmons gets into it with Colton after the whistle. As Giordano, I think, thought, or rather Mikheyev thought, that he had put that one in from the short side. And behind the net, Colton gets it to the blue paint. And now after the play is over, there is Perry. And here comes Maroon, and here we go again.
Oh, this could get ugly here as you got some guys on the ice that are willing combatants. Clifford being one of them. Perry the other, Maroon also, and Bogosian. Well, perhaps there is some message sending in this game, or maybe it's just more frustration from the Leafs. But Perry's one of those guys who's always around it, no matter what. He's always getting his nose in there.
So while the yard sale is cleaned up and players head to the box, we will step aside. 6-1 Tampa Bay. A message sending game possibly for the Lightning. To about 12 minutes past now, and maybe that'll be Brian Boucher. He will have earned it. As will this officiating crew, because Dave Jackson, our referee expert, joins us now. And Jax, I'm sure the officials in this game would love to just run off the last 12 minutes and avoid any other altercations, but how do you deal with a lopsided game where it seems like after every single stoppage, we get sticks and gloves up?
Yeah, well, I tell you, these games are actually a lot of fun. There's a lot going on. There's so much playoff atmosphere, and you're aware of what's at stake. The score is out of hand, so in these kind of scrums, you always want to try and find a differential. You always want to try and make a team pay, have them have a power play or kill a penalty. But in this case, with a 6-1 score with about 10 minutes to go, a power play doesn't really matter that much. The teams know they're going to get the message. Get the troublemakers off the ice. They'll cool down, and we'll get this game over with.
Well, the officials right now on the headset as some type of review is underway.
I think it's for
the replay center in Toronto, and I guess they're probably taking a look at whether or not a minor or major penalty is going to be called after that last scrum.
Yeah, for high stick is what I'm suspecting. And you could see Corey Perry when he was skating to the penalty box before we went to break. He was talking about like almost like a chop over the top of the head. So the officials having a look.
And once again, the penalty boxes are approaching standing room only. Fun to hear an official, though, say this is a game that's almost enjoyable to be a part of.
After video review of a major penalty, we have a match penalty for high sticking for number 43, Toronto. That's a 5-minute match penalty. Number 44, Toronto, we have 2 minutes roughing. And number 10, Tampa Bay, we have 4 minutes roughing. What will go on the board is 5 minutes will go on the board for Toronto. 2 minutes will go on the board for Tampa Bay.
That's the kind of explanation we need. That was very, very nicely done by Kevin Pollock. So ultimately, there will be a 3-minute power play on the back end. But let's take a look at Clifford as the stick comes over the top. And where is the match penalty, Bush?
Well, I mean, the idea that he's got his stick and he's bonking players over the top of the head. See right there. I mean, Perry doesn't have a helmet. So right there. I mean, you could see it's not with great force, but you could see the intent.
And Dave Jackson, let's bring you back in. Is intent enough there, even without causing any type of injury, for the officials to say, yes, that's worthy of a major?
Absolutely. There doesn't have to be an injury, just intent to injure. And any reasonable person would know that you bop a guy over the head with your stick when he doesn't have a helmet on is an intent to injure. And especially in a 6-1 game, you know that he's not just playing the game of hockey or it's just a regular scrum. He doesn't really care at that point. So I think it's a great call by the officials.
Well, there you go. I mean, that's why we've got Dave Jackson. I agree. I mean,
down to 25 seconds of the 4-on-4. TJ Brody as his teammates change up, and now away from the play. We've got a couple of more players in front of the benches getting into it as Mikheyev, I think, and Killorn got together, and from across the ice, it looks like Kevin Pollock blew the whistle. So they both go to the box.
Yeah, Mikheyev with a little contact.
Number 17,
with Killorn.
Tampa Bay, 2 minutes on sportsmanlike conduct. Number 65, Toronto, 2 minutes slashing.
There are no seats left.
No. A lot of camaraderie in that box right now.
O'Reilly, the first player set to exit in 17 seconds. And so it looks like he might as well for a very dangerous Minnesota Wild team.
Okay, you think about
on the board for Tampa.
You think about Fiala all year long. I mean, he's had interchanging parts on his line. You know, he's had Freddie Gaudreau, but until they got Matt Boldy, there was not a lot of continuity on that line, and yet he still managed to produce. Maroon and Simmons having another chit-chat.
And this time, with the play continuing at the other end, they're going to be separated, and I think just heading off to their respective benches as the linesmen jump in before either can drop the gloves.
I got to think they're both going to get misconducts here. Get a look here. The high hit by Simmons on Sergachev. And you can see Simmons leave his feet there.
Toronto penalty number 24. Tampa Bay penalty number 14. 10 minutes each for inciting.
So both those guys will hit the showers, but you can see why Maroon was upset. I mean, it was a high hit by Simmons in a game that is really meaningless right now, and Simmons is a guy that typically is not one that does stuff like that.
Yeah, Dave Jackson is, I guess, 10 minutes for incitement is one way to say it. Is that just the official saying, guys, you both get 10 minutes for, I don't want to deal with either of you the rest of the night?
Well, that's pretty much it. It's 10 minutes for unsportsmanlike conduct. There is a rule, inciting, it's a 10-minute misconduct. Trying to start fights, not listening to the referee, not following directions, saying get off the ice, get in your bench. It's just a way to prevent anything further happening later in the game.
Time now, and there's been a lot of inconsistencies in their game, and obviously.
And now Bunting rips the glove and the stick away from Perry, and we have another altercation. And
Perry in the middle of it again. I wonder if the officials will send Perry to the showers. as he seems to be around it all night long.
10-minute misconduct.
So there's 10 minutes that sends Bunting down the tunnel.
See, Perry was there waiting for him, and Bunting with the cross check, and I'm surprised maybe they don't even get Perry out of here either. I mean, he seems to be the guy that is infuriating the Leafs on a consistent basis. Having played against Corey Perry.
Moved up the wall as Foot was there to pinch in and keep it alive. Now it's out to the neutral zone. Chernak brings it right back across, and now Foot, he gets into it with Kerfoot. The clock continued to run for quite a while after the officials blew the play dead, but that's almost the timekeepers saying, if wishing made it so. They might be trying to save the players from themselves, just running the clock down as Foot heads back to the dressing room, and Kerfoot will do the same for Toronto.
What I thought would have stopped a long time ago, it certainly hasn't, as the tempers continue to flare as this third period wears on.
Toronto number 15, we have 2 minutes for cross-checking. Tampa Bay, we have 2 minutes for high sticking and 2 minutes roughing. 2 minutes on the board, number 52.
So it will be a power play for the last 49 seconds for Toronto.
See Foot with the elbow in on Kerfoot. He saw Kerfoot coming, so he wanted to get body position and just kind of reverse him. The elbow ended up catching Kerfoot, and you could see those two guys continued it at center ice.